All right, I'll go ahead and call the Jonesboro City Council meeting to order on Tuesday, April the 4th. First item is our pledge, and our invocation will be given by Alderman Bobby Long. If you would, please rise with me.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Father, we thank you for this day, and we thank you for this time that you've given us to gather and do the work and decisions for this city. We pray now for your wisdom, your guidance, and your understanding as we delve into these issues that are so important to so many people. We pray, Father, that you just give us understanding. Father, let the debate and the questions be asked and the conversation be civil tonight. And we pray, Father, that you give us the right decisions and that we would have the courage to do what is good and right for the city and for the people of Jonesboro. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Okay, our next item is roll call.
Come on, Joe.
Mr. Frierson. Mr. Vance.
Here.
Dr. Coleman.
Here.
Mr. Moore?
Mr. Moore sent me a message and asked that I tell you that he's gotten tied up on a project and couldn't get here tonight.
Thank you. Ms. Williams?
Here.
Mr. Gibson?
Here.
Mr. Street?
Here.
Mr. Johnson?
Here.
Mr. Dover?
Here.
Mr. Hafner?
Here.
Mr. Long?
Here.
And Mr. McLean?
Here.
Okay. The next item on our agenda is actually special presentation. It's always a delight for us and Mayor's Office of Jonesboro City Council and all of our 585 employees to recognize people in the community that has done something exceptionally well and outstanding. So we have two presentations tonight, and the first one is our Westside High School, who is a 2017 state championship bowling team. So I have a proclamation, and I'd like to read that if I can. It says, whereas the city of Jonesboro is blessed with an abundance of outstanding institutions of learning known for both their academic and athletic excellence. Among those institutions has been and continues to be Westside High School. And whereas the school's most recent athletic accolades were earned at the Arkansas State Bowling Conference in Cabot, Arkansas, where the Westside High School bowling team won the 2017 5A-4A state championship. And whereas the Warriors won the state bowling tournament a total pin count of 4,115. Lane Bond tied for the first place in the state individual competition, and the team is led by Coach Celeste Tinsley. And whereas their accomplishments both on and off the lanes have led to their development of character and integrity, representing their school, their families, and this city with distinction. And now, therefore, I herald parent by the authority vested in me by the citizens of Jonesboro and the state of Arkansas, do hereby acknowledge and honor the Westside bowling team for their efforts and their accomplishments, and congratulating them on a job well done and wishing them much success in the future. So let's give the hand to Westside bowling.
This is an athletic mecca. Good job, guys.
Right. Our next is our junior auxiliary, and I know that there's some. Here we go. I think everyone knows and probably read, I'm sure, and have seen on television and news our Jonesboro Junior Auxiliary. This group has done an exceptional job and does every year for the citizens of Jonesboro. I can tell you that as mayor that the Junior Auxiliary has donated to the Miracle League already $26,500, but they also pledged $10,000 a year for 10 years. So they're in their seventh year, and that'd be a total contribution to our Miracle League and your Miracle League of $126,500.
Wow.
In addition to that, they also do the Consolidated Youth Services, the Learning Center, Literacy, and more. And they also have given out $75,000 this year alone in scholarships to our kids in this area. So it's certainly a privilege and an honor for me to read this proclamation. The proclamation reads, whereas the Junior Auxiliary of Jonesboro, Arkansas, a chapter of 69-year-old National Association of Junior Auxiliaries, Inc., represents a serious endeavor on the part of women to be active and constructive participants in this community and to assume responsibility, leadership, in meeting community needs. And whereas the mission of the National Association of Junior Auxiliaries, Inc., is to encourage members and chapters to render charitable services which are beneficial to the general public, with particular emphasis on children, and to cooperate with other organizations performing similar services. And whereas the Junior Auxiliary of Jonesboro, Arkansas, works actively to perform the mission of the National Association of Junior Auxiliaries, Inc., in this community, we appreciate its efforts. And now, therefore, I would like to proclaim Junior Auxiliary Week this week and encourage all citizens, civic and fraternal groups, news media, and other community organizations to join in the salute to the Junior Auxiliary volunteers who have been an important presence in this community since 1950. So I'd like to present that to the Junior Auxiliary. Okay? Going back to work on a project now? Okay, the next item is item number 5, which is our consent agenda.
Move to adopt unless changes are noted.
I'd like to pull one off, resolution 17-032.
Resolution
17-032.
18? No, 17-032. Okay, is that 38? I apologize. Up here at the top, 32?
Yes.
Okay. All right. So is that a motion?
Yes.
Do we have a second on that?
Second.
Okay. I have a motion, a second, that we approve with the exception of resolution 17-032 would be pulled. Any comment or questions? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed. All right, resolution 17-032.
The big question I had.
Let me read it first.
Go ahead, I'm sorry. I always do that, though.
That's okay. Resolution to make appointments and reappointments to boards and commissions as recommended by Mayor Perrin. Whereas the following appointments and reappointments have been recommended by Mayor Harold Perrin, now therefore be it resolved by the City Council for the City of Jonesboro, Arkansas, that the following boards and commissions, appointments and reappointments be confirmed. Advertising and Promotion Commission, appointment of Jerry Morgan to fill the unexpired term of Tom Beasley with an expiration date of April 30, 2018. Community Transportation Advisory Board, JETS, appointment of Norma Farrell to a 3-year term with an expiration date of April 1, 2020. Jonesboro Parking Authority, reappointment of Mike Ebert and Ted Hargett to 5-year terms with an expiration date of April 1, 2022. Land Use Advisory Committee, reappointment of Kevin M. Bowden to a 5-year term with an expiration date of April 1, 2022. Appointment of Joey Mazzal to a 5-year term with an expiration date of April 1, 2022. Municipal Airport Commission, reappointment of Vic Ditta and Brian Fulkerson to 5-year terms with an expiration date of April 1, 2022.
Okay.
All right, that was just one to know. I don't remember seeing everybody, the names that were given, so I just wanted to know who all was being appointed. Maybe I missed it through something, but just wanted to see who I was being nominated before I gave my okay.
Okay. When we get any of these on here, some of these are just reappointments to that, and mm-hmm. they've asked to be reappointed. But anything that is, say, a new appointment, you all get a copy of their resumes mm-hmm. beforehand. Crystal sends that out to you. And in many of these cases, on the new appointment, we only got the one there. So I think you all got those, every one of them.
Yeah.
So is that...
That's correct, but I didn't see it in this format beforehand. I wanted
Are you talking about how it appears on the agenda?
Yes.
I was going to make that recommendation anyway. Whenever these are entered, we need to start putting the committees and who's being recommended, maybe this part of it, instead of just the title.
Oh, you're talking about the title up here?
You can, but a lot of times the press, everybody that gets the agenda, they have no idea who is being appointed and what committees.
Any resolution we do under this section.
Well, a lot of the title in the resolution is self-explanatory with the exception of that. Same thing with condemnations.
Well, we can do that. That's not a problem. If you feel like we need to add at the title at the very top, then you could read that and we could have it. Because this is actually on the website by 4 o'clock on what, Thursday, Donna? On 4 o'clock Thursday, but if you want to look at it prior...
Actually, it's 10 o'clock on Thursday, but you have the 4 o'clock as mayor.
Right. With
to make changes.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Move to adopt.
Second.
Okay. I have a motion and a second for adoption. Any comment or any questions? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed. All right. All right. Our next item is item number 6. This is new business.
Hey, Mayor. Did we actually vote on the consent agenda?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I thought we voted for that.
I think we did vote.
Yeah, we did.
It,
we
pulled it out. It was to pass the consent agenda with the exception of resolution.
You pulled it out, and then it comes. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, item number 6 is ordinance for first reading, ordinance 17016. This is an ordinance to amend chapter 117 on the zoning ordinance providing for changing zoning boundaries from one LUO to C3 LUO for property located at 2904 and 2906 Stallings Lane, is requested by Sharon Stallings.
Offer by title only.
An ordinance to amend Chapter 117, known as the Zoning Ordinance, providing for changes in zoning boundaries from CR1 LUO to C3 LUO for property located at 2904 and 2906 Stallings Lane, as requested by Sharon Stallings.
Mayor, I ask that we hold this to one reading, please.
Okay. Is that what you want to do, just hold it to one reading?
Yes.
Okay. All right. So we'll have to do that. All right, the next item, item number 7, is unfinished business. These are ordinances for a third reading. This is ordinance 13020. This is an ordinance to amend chapter 117, known as zoning ordinances, providing for changing zoning boundaries from R1 to RS7, R1 to EDRM, the property located at Kelly and Lexus Street, as requested by Unico Bank.
An ordinance to amend Chapter 117, known as the Zoning Ordinance, providing for changes in zoning boundaries from R1 to RS7 and R1 to PDRM for property located at Keeley and Lexi Street, as requested by Unico Bank.
Okay. Mr. Parker, I'm going to go ahead and let you go first, if I may. legal counsel for Unico Bank.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Mayor just indicated I represent Unico Bank and also the Watson Family Trust. There are two representatives tonight that are here with me from Unico Bank. That's Jonathan May, the president of Unico, and Barry LaFarlett, who is the senior vice president of Unico Bank. As you all are aware, tonight we are here reconsidering this rezoning petition by order of Circuit Judge John Fogelman. You know, as Yogi Berra might say, it's deja vu all over again. So if you read Judge Fogelman's order, he was clear that zoning decisions are to be made by the City Council and not by the courts, unless those decisions are arbitrary, capricious, or unreasonable. I've given you all a handout with a number of documents. And if you'll look at tab A, if you don't have it handy, there's a copy of Judge Fogelman's order there. Judge Fogelman directed this council to follow its own ordinances and to specifically consider the approval criteria contained in Jonesboro City Ordinance 117-34. And that ordinance is at tab E for your reference if you don't have that handy. The judge recognized that the MAPC is only an advisory body when it comes to zoning and rezoning. However, when the MAPC thoroughly studies the proposal, considers the criteria mandated by city ordinances, and makes a recommendation to the city council for rezoning of property, Judge Fogelman stated the city council appears to act arbitrarily and capriciously if it departs from the MAPC's recommendations without a sound basis. Judge Fogelman went on to observe that if the court were to find that the MAPC's recommendation was meaningless and the city council could ignore the recommendation, Unico Bank would be left without a remedy to stop the arbitrary and capricious actions of the city. The court was clear in its findings that the MAPC performed its job and considered the criteria set forth for approval in the Jonesboro Code of Ordinances. The court held that the MAPC determined that Unico Bank's amended application met the criteria for zoning changes and followed good land use planning with certain conditions as enumerated. That's found at paragraph 13 of Judge Fogelman's order. Judge Fogelman also found that in reviewing the analysis done of the amendments to the zoning ordinance map from June of 2009 through December of 2012, only 57% of those ordinance changes were consistent with the land use map plan. That confirms what is regularly stated about the land use plan map, in that it's a guide, not a requirement. And that's at tab G, is the land use plan. So now it's up to this body to consider the criteria set forth in section 117-34 of the Jonesboro Code of Ordinances. To depart from the MAPC's finding only if you determine there's a sound basis for doing so in accordance with Judge Fogelman's order. So to refresh your memory, what was before you, and there we have some new council members that were not here when the initial rezoning came before you in 2013. Unico Bank is requesting rezoning of two tracts totaling a little over 48 acres. Property lies on the edge of the city limits off Ingalls Road. Unico Bank has acquired one tract by foreclosure. That was a 31-acre tract, and has an adjacent tract under contract with the Charles R. Watson Family Trust, consisting of a little over 17 acres. The Watson parcel is being purchased solely to provide access to a portion of the Unico Bank tract from Ingalls Road. The rezoning request comes before the City Council with a favorable recommendation from the MAPC. There are actually two rezoning proposals packaged in this one application. Both tracts are currently zoned R1. This property was part of a mass annexation in the 80s, and all of the annexed property was annexed as R1 property. This property and the surrounding agriculture property has been vacant and undeveloped since annexation over 25 years ago. The first part of the rezoning request is for RS7. 8.81 acres, which will mirror the existing development in Caldwell Acres, which, by the way, is actually zoned R3, LUO. The second part of the rezoning proposal is for a PDRM, Land Development Multifamily, which consists of approximately 40 acres. The RS7 will be an 8.81-acre buffer between the existing single-family development in Caldwell Acres and the proposed planned development. Proposed RS7 property will be accessed by Keeley and Lexi and will allow for those two streets to be connected, improving fire, health, and safety coverage in the Caldwell Acres subdivision. The 8.81-acre tract will act as a buffer to the multifamily and will serve as the transition area to the multifamily. There will also be a perimeter fence between the RS7 property and the multifamily property. And as stated by the judge and by the Planning Commission, it exemplifies sound planning principles. But what's the total project like? There'll be 217 mixed units. 37 of those will be single-family lots, and then there'll be 22 single-level duplex lots, total of 44 units. There'll be 12 single-level fourplex lots, yielding 48 units. And there'll be 22 townhouse-style fourplexes, yielding 88 units, for a total of 180 units in the multifamily portion. Density in the proposed RS7 area in the 8.81 acres is 5.2 units per acre and is consistent with the current density in the development in Coldwell Acres. The density in the planned development is virtually identical at 5.4 units per acre. As required under the planned development guidelines, a minimum of 20% or slightly less than 8 acres are to be set aside for the common area and open space within the planned development. This plan certainly meets those criteria, actually exceeds those criteria. In this proposal, 8.36 acres are actually being set aside. And you'll see in the plans that there's an area set aside at the entrance for a bus stop for either school or MATA access. It is anticipated that the rent ranges in the multifamily will likely be in the $800 to $950 per unit range, given the land cost and development cost associated with this project. The plan district proposal gives the MAPC extensive control in the development of this property. And by approving this rezoning request as a plan development, the MAPC and this city council are retaining a great deal of control over the development. Future development must follow this plan exactly as proposed. Otherwise, the developer must come back before the MAPC and the City Council if changes are sought. Additional requirements and stipulations may also be added when the site plan is reviewed by the MAPC. Proposed RS7 property, the single family portion, will be accessed, as I said, by Neely and Lexi. The 37 single-family lots will act as a buffer and will serve as the transition to the multifamily area. Again, I want to be very clear because this came up in our first meeting in visiting with a couple of the residents from Coldwell Acres. There will be no access from Lexi and Keeley into the multifamily development, and likewise, there will be no access from the multifamily development into Coldwell Acres. Also, all access to the multifamily planned development area will be via Ingalls and Willow Road. As I'm sure some of you are aware, Ingalls Road is designated as a minor arterial road. Under the comprehensive land use plan, multifamily development is allowed on a minor arterial road. By providing a single family buffer in the RS7 zoning request, Pinnacle Bank, as the owner of the property, is assuming the economic risk that we'll be able to sell the RS7 property, since it would adjoin multifamily property. No residents of Caldwell Acres are being asked to assume that risk. To the contrary, this proposal allows for development of a full street in two rows of single-family houses as buffer to duplex lots, not triplexes. Not fourplexes, but duplexes, single-level duplexes. And most importantly, I think, based on the concerns we heard raised at the first meeting back in March, this proposal will actually decrease the traffic in Coldwell Acres. Additionally, a perimeter fence is required and will again separate the single-family from the multifamily. As I mentioned, this property lies on the edge of the city limits. Has adequate utilities to accommodate the proposed rezoning and fronts a minor arterial road. The project is 1 mile from down Willow Road from the bypass, I-555, and a half a mile from the Optic Fiber Park. As this council knows, it's sparsely populated along Willow and Ingalls Road, the primary route used to access land development. As you can tell from the plan and looking at the application, To the west of the Unico tract is the Caldwell Acres, R3 GO. Again, the same density is being requested of RS7. West of the Watson tract is zoned R1, presently used for agriculture purposes. North is also R1, presently used for agriculture purposes. To the east, also R1, presently used for agriculture purposes and owned by the Watson Family Trust. And to the south is also R1, presently used for agriculture purposes. The MAPC initially considered this proposal on December 11, 2012. At the request of the MAPC and without objection by Unico Bank, proposed rezoning was tabled until a hydrology study could be completed. Unico Bank engaged Bernie Ault, who I know many of you know and has done work for the city, to perform the hydrology study to determine the location of the floodway and determine the effect of the proposed development on the floodway. After Unico Bank spent $23,000 on this study, Mr. Ault determined that the floodway is currently located within the banks of Higginbottom Creek, and that will not change with the proposed development. In other words, he said there would be no adverse impact to this proposed development to the flooding or floodway in that area. And his report is contained at tab J. Additionally, as the council is aware, no development can be undertaken in any event without compliance with all federal guidelines concerning stormwater management. Now, also, as this council knows, virtually every multifamily rezoning request that comes before this council meets with significant opposition, sometimes more significant than others. And this proposal was no different. A petition was offered at both the MAPC and the council meetings in 2013. The petition contained 289 signatures. After visiting with a couple of you, there were some questions asked of me about that petition, and I had not really taken the time to go back and look at the petition. It's interesting that almost half of the signatures, 131 of the signatures, or 45%, live outside of Caldwell Acres. Some who signed the petition even live on Frog Pond Cove, which, as many of you know, is several miles away. But the opponents have raised three primary objections to this rezoning request. Increased traffic, increased crime, and declining property values. I'll address each of those in that order. Increased traffic. Access to the proposed plan development will be solely from Ingalls Road, again designated as a minor arterial road under the land use plan. There will be no access to the planned development from Keeley or Lexi in Caldwell Acres. The planned development will result in far less traffic in Caldwell Acres than if the entire acreage was developed as single family with sole access via these two streets. In other words, if it were developed all as Caldwell Acres has been developed, just the Unico tract would yield 111 lots, all pouring out through Lexi and Keeley, as opposed to 37 lots, or reduction of 74 lots otherwise using Lexi and Keeley. It's also very important to note that given the density of the development, the planned development will not result in any more traffic since the density is practically identical. 5.4 for the multifamily, 5.2 for the single family. Also want to direct your attention to tab F in the handout I gave you. I'm not sure all of you saw that email exchange prior to the last vote. Mark Nichols, the city traffic engineer, has stated that numerous studies have shown that multifamily developments generate fewer trips per unit versus single family residences by as much as 30%. Mr. Nichols stated that his initial study indicates that during the peak morning hours at 7:15 to 8:15, The 180 multifamily units will generate approximately 150 vehicle trips leaving the property. Taking into account the additional traffic load on Willow Road, which now has an average daily volume, or at least in 13, had an average daily traffic volume of 2,300 vehicles. Mr. Nichols does not anticipate that the development will have a significant impact on traffic along Willow Road. Thus, this multifamily development with the density practically equivalent to the adjacent single-family residential will result in less traffic in this area, not more traffic. Given the fact that this proposed development is single-family level duplexes and single-level and townhome-style fourplexes, we believe that the absorption rate will take anywhere from 5 to 10 years, which we think also would be quite similar to a single-family development. This planned development for multifamily will not be developed like a high-density multifamily complex, like the student housing complex that's currently being constructed out on Johnson behind J-Town Grill. Now, for increased crime, I think that we all can agree that statistics show that crime increases when there's a higher density of people living in a smaller area. Look at the hot spots of criminal activity in the city. Those that were presented when this was originally considered in 13, and it hadn't changed a lot since then. Without exception, the hot spots are all in areas where there is a higher concentration of people living in a smaller geographic area. That's not the case with this proposal. It is critically important to understand that density in this planned development is 5.4 units per acre, which again is virtually identical to Caldwell Acres at 5.2 units per acre. Decreased property values. Well, this is the classic red herring argument. There is absolutely no evidence that multifamily development decreases values in adjacent neighborhoods. Because if there were any empirical data remotely suggesting that fact, the opponents would have presented it. There has been no data presented because there is none to support this. Some of you have been on the council a long time. You may remember a few years ago, the Latourette family had a rezoning proposal before you to increase the multifamily area off Latourette Drive, off South Caraway. There were a number of residents at that time living in Medallion Acres that were opposed to that rezoning. You'll also recall that there had already been some multifamily that was originally rezoned at the very end, which was adjacent to Medallion Acres. At that time, and this was all presented to the council, we looked at all the sales of the homes in Medallion Acres since the time that the multifamily units had been constructed. With the exception of two sales, all of the properties in Medallion Acres had sold for more money than the purchase price when the owner originally bought the property. Those two exceptions were bank-owned real estate, foreclosed property. Everybody knows that foreclosed property never sells for what the purchase price was. Also, I want to direct your attention to an article that appeared a few weeks ago in the Arkansas Democrat. That's a tab K. Very interesting article about a study that was performed by Professor Michael Craw at the University of Arkansas at Little Rock. And his study was actually commissioned by the city of Little Rock. Professor Craw's study showed that for the most part, multifamily projects don't harm home prices or cause an uptick in crime to an area, a finding similar to other studies in other cities that he cited. This study covered all house sales within 2,000 feet of all new multifamily housing built in Little Rock between 2000 and 2016. The study showed that condominium developments resulted in a 7% increase to home values in the surrounding area, while small market rate apartments, not large apartment complexes, but really what we're talking about in this request, Small market rate apartments increased home values 10%. Additionally, in 2013, when Unico Bank first presented this rezoning request, we reviewed the real estate records and determined that at least 32% of the houses in Caldwell Acres were rental units, and only about 68% were primary residences. I think that anybody, if they stop and think about it, could see and agree that there is that a significant number of rental homes in a neighborhood has more to do with decreasing home values than just about anything else. So in summary, the plan development district proposal gives the MAPC and this city council extensive control in the development of the multifamily portion of this property. Future development must follow this plan as it's proposed, or the developer must come back before the MAPC and this body to seek any change or modification. As I stated, additional stipulations could always be added at that point, as well as when the site plan is actually reviewed by the MAPC. It is important to note that providing the single-family buffer in the RS7 zoning request, Unico Bank, as owner of the property, is assuming the economic risk that we'll be able to market and sell the lots, since it would adjoin a planned development multifamily. No residents of Caldwell Acres are being asked to assume this risk. To the contrary, this proposal allows for the development of a full street in two rows of single-family homes as a buffer to two rows of duplex, single-level duplex lots. There will also be a perimeter fence separating the single-family from the multifamily. Actually, as recommended by the Planning Commission, there will be a perimeter fence around the entire multifamily development. This method of development allows for an orderly transition from single-family to single-level duplexes, then to single-level fourplexes, and then, as you go out of the development towards Ingalls Road, to townhouse-style fourplexes. And again, I know I've said a lot, but I want everyone to understand the density is virtually the same. 5.2 units per acre in Caldwell Acres, 5.4 units in the planned development. The property is located on the edge of the city limits. It has adequate utilities to accommodate the proposed rezoning and fronts a minor arterial road. Currently, it is sparsely populated on Will and Ingle Roads, the primary routes used to access the planned development. Most importantly, this property is not located in an area where there are already large-scale multifamily developments, thus avoiding a high concentration of dense multifamily development. We have heard time after time after time that it's better to spread out multifamily development and not have it concentrated in one area. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a perfect opportunity because this proposed project is at the edge of the city limits. It is not adjacent to any existing single-family homes. There is no other multifamily development near. Most importantly, the MAPC considered the criteria for approval as set forth in the Jonesboro Code of Ordinances, Section 117 through 34, in two separate meetings, not just one. MAPC determined that the Unico Bank's amended application met the criteria for zoning changes and followed good land use planning with certain conditions. For all of these reasons, we still believe that this is one of the best multifamily proposals that's been before you in quite some time. We respectfully request that you focus solely on this proposal and that you judge this proposal on its merits and its compliance with the Jonesboro Code of Ordinances as directed by Judge Fogelman. We believe, and Judge Fogelman actually found, that the MAPC thoroughly reviewed and vetted this project and made its recommendation to this body. We request that you follow the MAPC's recommendation and approve this rezoning. We thank you again for your consideration of this request.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Parker. Is anyone in the audience who would like to speak in opposition to this?
Yes, My name is Philip Cook. I live at 5216 Richardson Drive, which is just down the street where he's talking about. He said that this project is located several miles from Frog Pond. What do you call several miles? Not several miles, it's about 2 miles. The streets along Richardson, which takes you to Frog Pond, is barely wide enough for the pavement. This side of the pavement, you drop off into a deep ditch. This side, you drop off in another deep ditch. It's about 25 foot wide, maybe. That, to me, is a problem. We have a lot of trucks comes up and down those roads now, and when people are out walking or bike riding, which everybody wants bike trails and walking trails, they've been using these streets as that. And if they come to the point that they're going to do this, they're going to be adding more traffic. And I don't understand how more people are going to produce less traffic in an area. That don't add up to me. I'll be glad to let him explain to me how that works. I don't know how more makes less. Well, I think the city needs to reconsider this and think about it very much as to what they're getting into. They need to look at the whole picture, not just what he's been presented to here tonight. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Cook. Anyone else? This time I'd like to bring up Daryl Smith, senior planner. Daryl, if you would, I know you have reviewed this review again. If you could state to the mayor and the council your feelings or what you think about that.
Well, I mean, this was looked at a couple of years ago, and I know that the MAPC and Otis, who was here before, they did their research on this and they did look at it. I'm not sure I would have had the exact same recommendations. I may have looked at it a little differently. I mean, nobody looks at everything the same way. But it's hard for me to go back and say they did anything wrong. I would be concerned with the road width. I know that, but that's all something that can be brought out during the development phase too. But I would have been concerned with the road width. And if I was looking at homes alone, I would be concerned with spot zoning, except Caldwell Acres is zoned multifamily instead of single family. But other than that, I don't see that they did anything wrong. Like I said, everybody looks at things different. I would have looked very hard at the traffic out there as far as the road width, making sure we have adequate access into the development. And other than that, that's would have been about the only differences that I would see.
Okay. So, again, based on our city ordinance at 117-34, which Judge Fogelman referred to in this, and based on you being the senior planner, then what is your feeling as to would you concur with this rezoning?
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to ask some questions first before he gives that.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Sure.
Okay. Is my mic working? Check.
Your voice is.
My voice is not. On these criteria that we related to, will someone read that? I'm not. It says approval criteria.
Yes, sir.
Is the criteria for approving of a rezoning are set out in this subsection. Not all the criteria must be given equal consideration by the Planning Commission or City Council in reaching a decision. The criteria considered shall be include but not limited to the following.
That's correct.
So basically what they're saying, these are some guidelines, but they're not in total things that we have to consider. We can consider things that's not listed
there,
here.
There can be other things for consideration.
So it wouldn't be arbitrary and capricious if we chose some other criteria that we thought was important.
Well, I guess that'd be up to the judge to make that decision.
What I'm saying is, though, you know, we have a rationale. It doesn't have to be these six or seven things that they keep referring to. And I'd like to go to the next sentence. It says, consistency of the proposal with the comprehensive plan. If you refer back to the MAPC report on criteria A, under the consistency, do you have that in front of you?
Mm-hmm.
Will you read that for me, please?
It says it's partially consistent with the adopted land use plan. It's inconsistent as multifamily.
Inconsistent as multifamily.
That's correct.
Okay. Now, go back to the other section that says consistency. I don't see the word partial consistency. Do you?
On
back on the, our seven criteria.
On to A.
On page one, on
it says
section
criteria A.
It doesn't say partial consistency, does it? It says consistency.
It says consistency.
And my next question is, what is partial consistency? 20%, 10%, 30%, 50%.
It's kind of like, did you run the stop sign or didn't you run the stop sign? Mm-hmm. Maybe a little bit, maybe not.
Okay, so would you say the MAPC followed these rules if our planning commission said it was inconsistent as multifamily? So they did not follow the recommendation from our planning commission, did they?
You're going to have to catch me up just a little bit.
Now I'm looking at criteria A.
Looking at A.
Consistency of the proposal with a comprehensive plan. It says partially consistent, which I ask you, what is partially consistent?
Right. And it says inconsistent as multifamily.
So with that statement from our planning commission, so the MAPC did not take Otis's and commission's recommendation?
They didn't.
According to on criteria A.
If you look at just plain multifamily, no.
Okay, thank you. That's all I need to know.
Hey, Darryl, do you have any, do you agree with the density as they proposed it?
That's not that dense out there. I mean, the density's not bad out there. I don't know if I'd set it out exactly the way they have it set out, but, you know, everybody does everything different.
Okay.
But 5.2 to 5.4, that's pretty.
Okay.
And as it's currently zoned right now, I think I read in the May 21st, 2013 MAPC report that they could put 260 additional homes could be developed out there.
That's what the report.
And what they proposed, to make sure I understand this, is between the 37 single family, the 22 single level duplexes, which I guess are not really considered multi-family, 12 single level fourplexes and 22 or threeplexes. No, those are fourplexes, and then the townhouse style fourplexes. That's 217 units, right? About,
yeah, I'd have.
So
260. Yes.
And do you agree with Mark's email regarding traffic impact?
I can't argue with Mark. I mean, he's a traffic engineer. There's a lot of studies that show that when you do multifamily, you actually reduce it because of the you reduce traffic because of the times. Not everybody leaves at the same time in a multifamily as they do in a single family. There's a lot of studies that show that.
Darryl, did you see the discussion where it mentioned about the traffic? And I know Mr. Parker pointed out what Mark Nichols' opinion on that was, but it says department reviews were discussed, and the police department reported concerns with the added density and load on existing infrastructure and services by multifamily and its influences on crime. The MPO office issued concerns that the activity, future development to the east, connection to Willow Road and Colony Drive to the west, connectivity to the areas south towards the county was also a concern. Mr. Sprigg stated that there was a stub street that will connect toward Gladys Drive to the west. There's also a stub street to the south. But I don't think they really did focus on those concerns that were raised by the police department and the MPO, which are the police department's one of the considerations in the criteria, their opinion on it. And I know Chief Yates is not here tonight, and I guess that came through his. I don't know who actually made that determination in the department, but that was part of this record.
But here, I guess here's my question about that is, if it's developed as proposed or developed as currently zoned, the traffic impact is really about the same. If it's still, you know, because I know we talked about absorption on other multifamily things. That was one of your concerns.
It is.
And but to me, you know, 5 to 10 years to develop, if that's a good estimate, is, I mean, that gives time for traffic to be absorbed. It's not like a, you know, an R12 where there's going to be, you know, a lot of units at one time, you know, built and people hitting the street.
But it's as much as the absorption is when the road is going to be established. mean, right now it says it's a minor shows a minor arterial, but it's not built as a minor arterial. Right. But I don't know when we have that planned to be.
That's another point. There's nothing in our immediate planning for that street to be improved. Is there, Craig?
You know, when you look at this, I don't see hardly any of the criteria that actually says it's fully compliant. A says it's partially compliant. B says it's partially compliant. C says it may be compatible. The E, adverse impact on traffic, is in no doubt will be seen. G is partially consistent. I don't see much of anything that's fully compatible.
Well, imagine wondering what the MAPC was thinking.
I'm having to go back and guess on a lot of this because I wasn't there, but I'm thinking that what they were doing is, as a planned development, they were thinking that they could control some of this during the development phase. I mean, that's just how I would look at it if we were starting over today. I'd rather see it come in as a planned development than as a straight rezoning. But I can't tell you.
That would almost be speculative, then, wouldn't it?
I can't tell you.
Under criteria C, if you look at the last sentence, it noted specifically multifamily units may be construed as out of character with the surrounding area, and I would concur with that. It's almost as if it's spot zoning, even though that planning, or those developed on the south as R3, they've been developed as R1, single family. But just so we cover this, truly cover it, and try to do as the judge has ordered, would you mind orchestrating this where we go through each and every one of these criteria so we don't miss any and hop around and stuff? I want a clear record that we have covered, and we need to discuss each of these criteria before we vote on this again.
Okay. You have criteria A, which says consistency of the proposal with the comprehensive plan. Consistent, yes or no? The answer is partially consistent with the adopted land use plan. Inconsistent is multifamily.
Remember, what does partially consistent mean to me? How should I interpret that?
I don't know how each person interprets.
So basically, person A can interpret it one way, and person B can interpret it another way, and they both feel like they're answering correctly.
They could, yes.
So it wouldn't be arbitrary and capricious. It would be what they feel partially means.
I can't answer that part of it.
The way I read it is the single family portion of it they felt was consistent, but the multifamily portion of it was inconsistent.
That's correct.
Right. I wouldn't disagree with that.
Well, that's exactly what it says under tab H.
Yeah. Right.
Okay.
Have we ever deviated from our land use plan in past decisions?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes. It's just a plan.
Well, that's right. That's why it's called a plan.
Everybody wants to look at that if they're arguing that point that it's like Moses coming down from the mountain and it's chiseled in stone, and it's not. It's up for change, or it changes. It's a living plan.
You want me to go through the explanations also?
Yes, please.
All right, the explanation. The area to the west is currently zoned R3, high-density multifamily, but was developed as small-lot single-family residential.
So everything surrounding this is either built as single-family or is currently zoned single-family.
That's the way, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. B is consistency of the proposal with the purpose of the zoning ordinance. Consistency, yes or no? Partially consistent, where single-family is proposed. The applicant is pursuing the use of the new REM-8 zoning to the east.
Okay, now
REM-8 was multifamily units per acre.
So are they saying partially consistent? Why would it not be totally consistent with single family homes?
Again, I didn't write this.
As a city council person looking at this from the experts that are supposed to be writing this and giving this to us, I don't understand that statement.
The REM-8, I also believe, was changed to the, wasn't that the plan development multifamily? So they've made some changes to this from the original. But as far as partially consistent would be the single family part only.
So why would that be partially consistent?
Well, the single family is definitely consistent. There's no doubt.
Why would they not say that?
I can't tell you that.
When was the REM-8 new?
Okay, I'm not trying to put you on the spot. I'm just saying.
It was a new zoning. It was another option.
Like I said, if you're going to put multifamily in adjacent to single family, a planned development is the way to do it. And I think that's what they were. All right, C, compatibility of the proposal with the zoning uses and character of the surrounding area. Consistent, yes or no. Again, it says a low intense, low density multifamily proposal may be considered compatible. However, an additional or potential 315 multifamily units may be construed as out of character with the surrounding area.
Okay, maybe could go either way, correct?
Right.
So maybe might be considered one side that's okay. Maybe on the other person might think it wouldn't be okay.
On the explanation, it says an area adjacent to an unstudied floodway, floodplain, floodway challenges may need to be overcome. All right, D is suitability of the subject property for the uses to which it has been restricted without a proposed zoning map amendment. The area is suitable for single-family residential. As of right, the property could currently be developed having approximately 260 additional homes under the R1 zoning. Okay, and then the explanation on that, with floodplain challenges, the density levels may result in a number lower than the potential volumes listed.
So there was no maybe or if or and on that one, correct? No.
That's correct.
That was pretty plain
spoken. They're essentially confirming that it was,
R1 is the way it's supposed
to. Yeah, it's appropriate building is R1. There's no question if or maybe or partial.
But then what was proposed is less units.
All right, under your criteria number E or letter E, the extent to which approval of proposed rezoning will detrimentally affect nearby property, including but not limited to any impact on property value, traffic, drainage, visual, odor, noise, light, vibration, hours of use, operation, and any restrictions to the normal and customary use of the affected property. Okay, and then it's consistent, yes or no. Again, adverse impacts on traffic in no doubt will be seen as an issue to the surrounding residents. The master street plan recommends Ingalls Road as a minor arterial road. This sends a message that connectivity to the east is anticipated as a need in the very near future to effectively get traffic to Stadium Boulevard in a more efficient manner. Richardson Road, as well as an extension of Willow Road, as improved collectors need to be further studied to get the traffic north-south more effectively. See land use map above, which depicts the master street plan overlay.
So far, the only thing that I've seen that's been in no doubt or not in question is when it speaks that this should be seen as single-family residence, and there will, with no doubt, be traffic, adverse traffic effect. Are you right?
I think that's not the way that's reading. I think it's will be seen as an issue to the surrounding residents. Mm-hmm. That wasn't a statement by the city that there will be adverse impacts. It was will be seen as an issue to the surrounding residents.
Yeah. All right, and then the explanation on that is applicant has shown no commitment to address potential traffic impacts by this proposal to the area.
Okay, can I, Craig, Mr. Light, can you come to the podium, please? In looking at this area, are we in any studied this, proposed anything in the near future, or any of those areas that we're talking about to improve the traffic?
The traffic network in that area is fairly good. You have Willow Road, you have Ingalls Road, you have Richardson, you have Colony Park. I mean, those roads make connections. They do have roadside ditches on them. It's similar to a lot of the streets that we have in Jonesboro. Traffic volumes out there are very light. Any development in that area, if it be R1 or multifamily from this tract of property, you're not going to see that much impact. As the area continues to develop, that's when you're going to start seeing it. But this one piece in the straw that broke the camel's back. I mean, there's other developments going on out there as well.
Well, just following the MAPC recommendation that we study this, we haven't started that study yet.
Is that not what we did and what Mark did?
We looked at the traffic volumes in that area and the anticipated loads. I mean, a two-lane road can handle up to about 12,000 vehicles a day. South Caraway Road is still two-lane, and it's up to 14,000 vehicles a day. Willow Road has 2,600, I think, was what was reported. So in terms of traffic volume, there's still a lot of capacity left in what's out there. So it's not time to go add additional lanes to those roadways.
Daryl, do you know how many? I know there was some concern about the number of Nettleton buses that run through there. Do you know, is it 28 buses? No,
I can't give you the exact number, but we do run a lot of buses down through there.
I saw it somewhere, but I know that was a concern for some of the folks out there. Was the number of buses that interface on those narrow roads.
Y'all ready for F?
Yes. Okay. I am.
22 school buses, that's what it was.
The length of time the subject property has remained vacant is zoned, as well as its zoning at the time of purchase by the applicant. Land has been vacant for years and formerly utilized for agricultural purposes. And
what was the land zoned when it was purchased?
I'm sure it was R1.
Okay, thank you.
That's what it came in when it was annexed.
Okay.
G, impact of the proposed development on community facilities and services, including those related to utilities, streets, drainage, parks, open space, fire, police, and emergency medical services. Partially consistent with the adopted land use plan, inconsistent is multifamily. Explanation, impacts on city services, utilities, and emergency services are anticipated. This area falls within the Nettleton School District. The school board should be contacted for a letter of review recommendation.
Again, partially consistent, don't know what that means. And also, inconsistent is multifamily. So again, the MAPC did not take the recommendation on several of these.
Which is not the first time.
What was the vote on the MAPC?
I believe
vote?
It was 5-2. With
so 5-2. Okay, so it was not unanimous.
It was not unanimous.
Okay, as far as discussion purposes, what you've done now is you've gone through the initial report that was presented to MAPC with initial recommendations from the planner. Then there were several changes made during that planning commission meeting and restrictions placed on and studies done, and I think you should evaluate those to see if the changes makes... I think you should evaluate as it was finally approved as opposed to just how it was initially presented. So, for example, they made some changes to the zoning. They did the traffic study. They did the drainage study. I think y'all need to evaluate those as well for discussion purposes.
Be under tab H.
Yeah.
I think that is under H.
Yes. Yeah, March 12th.
A part of it's under H. What Mr. Parker handed out. Utica Bank has no objection, 120 feet right away, recommended by the staff report. Ingalls Road and no access to be allowed to Caldwell Acres. Utica Bank has no issues in limiting the density of the R. 5.5 units per acre. RS7 will have a density of 7 per acre. Goes on to say, next page, Unico Bank will agree to provide public transit, bus stops, and areas set aside. Unico Bank has expressed an interest and openness to further park areas to the incorporated into the buffer, which we have learned the city is unable to accept to offer green space for the buffer because of budgetary constraints throughout the city officials. Through city officials.
So, I would... Go ahead. Are you finished?
I'm just saying the next one was about the REM8. We anticipate this will be developed as duplexes, triplexes, fourplexes over a 3-year period.
I'd like to call your attention to the next paragraph. Staff says Mr. Spriggs gave a summary of the staff report, which I'm assuming included these changes. Consistency is achieved for the single family, except where multifamily is proposed. Consistency is not achieved with adopted land use plan. There was no partial, maybe. It's a definite statement. Would you not agree, Mr.
A definite statement with an indefinite plan.
Yeah.
Would you not agree with that? That's from our city planner. Basically stated that he agreed with the single family, but he disagreed with the multifamily meeting the adopted land use plan.
Hey, Darrell, can I ask a question on that one?
Yes, sir.
If this would have been zoned for multifamily and not residential, not R1 or R3, would he have made the same statement that this was, if they would have asked for it to be rezoned R1 or R3, would he, potentially, I know you're not him, but I think he probably would have made the same statement that it's not consistent with the land use plan, if the land use plan had called for this to be multifamily. I mean, that's kind of a standard comment, isn't it, that he makes anytime it's not consistent with the land use plan?
I can't
say. Yeah, I mean
speak for
as far as consistent at the time, R3 would have been a lot less consistent.
Mr. Smith, would you state that as we've gone through this, that our former city planner has made more statements stating that the multifamily is not consistent with the land use plan? And can you point out any one place where he said multifamily is consistent with the land use plan?
I cannot point out where he said it, where he specifically says it is consistent.
So the MAPC basically, by voting 5-2, did not follow Mr. Spriggs' recommendation according to the multifamily housing.
The MAPC based on the judge's order. I don't either. Because of this right here.
Yeah. Mr. Dover, You're painting me into a pretty small corner here.
I mean, basically, it's black and white.
I don't see where he said that it was consistent with multifamily. And if you're looking for that statement and then the MAPC voting for multifamily because of that, it's not in there.
I know they never addressed the traffic concerns either, that the police department appeared to have some concern. Our engineer, Mr. Nichols, neither one of them have a crystal ball, but the police department deals with problems in the area. They patrol it every day. I think they should carry a little weight, and that was never resolved in this. Here they just kind of glassed over it and hung. Both people made a statement, and that was pretty much it.
Yeah, the original report, didn't even have the report from the police department at the time. So, if they gave a statement, yes or no, it was never presented that I've seen in here. I mean,
okay. That was in this.
It was probably, was that in during the?
Yeah, it's in the discussions on
the
last March 12th.
It's not in the it wasn't in the staff recommendation portion of it.
Yeah, it's right under staff. It's the second paragraph under staff.
Yeah, it's tab I.
Oh, tab I, that's
right. Yeah, March 12th, 2013.
Oh, okay, all right.
But that just left both of them. You got the police department having concerns with the MPO, and then you've got a traffic engineer. He weighs in too with his opinion, but they never really did. They both just put statements out there, and that's just hanging there. There's no one won the day.
Mr. Street, the only thing I'll point out is that MAPC was done on March 12, 2013, and then the traffic study appears to have been done after that because the email's dated April 5, 2013. So I don't know if it appears to me that the study was done maybe after the police department raised their concerns. It was definitely, the email's definitely dated after.
Yeah, of course, they typically don't have a study in front of them when they're asked to do these. They're basing it on what they see from their
experience.
Their call load and the problems that they have, and they did express concerns with the multifamily and the influence on crime. So they weighed in on both of those.
I want to make sure on one.
Mr. Street, I want to point out just one thing. I know it's all been a long time since we've all looked at this before. I believe it was Mr. Cook who initially sent an email to all of you all, including the mayor and the city planner and maybe the city engineer, raising concerns about the traffic. And it was in response to that email that the mayor asked Mark Nichols to look at it and weigh in. And so what you have before you was actually what's done after the MAPC made their recommendation, but before the council considered this the first time and voted in June of 13.
Yeah, I want to make it clear, make sure this is understood. In Section H, after all the changes were made by the people who were asking for this rezoning, Mr. Spriggs still said that multifamily is not consistent with the land use plan. After all, the concessions were made by the applicant. Is that correct?
What it says is he gave a summary of the staff report. Consistency is achieved for the single family, except for multifamily is proposed. Consistency is not achieved with the adopted land use plan.
But now this is after they have came back and made the concessions that we alluded to a few minutes ago.
This is in under H that you're
right. That's
about
the December 11th meeting.
That's the concessions that they made.
And then there was a March 12th meeting.
All right.
March where it was considered again. And I don't know that the opinion changes. I just want to be clear that was the first meeting.
Right
on the back.
Okay. Mr. Spriggs gave additional comment from staff noting that this is a continuance of the issue that was tabled by the commission. Public input was given in December. The MAPC had concerns of providing a buffer to protect the single-family subdivision. MAPC discussed a 280-foot buffer from single-family, thus situating the multifamily near the ditch area. The applicant revised the plan. The department reviews were discussed. Police report reported concerns with added density and load on existing infrastructure and services by multifamily and its influences on crime. MPO office issued concerns with connectivity of future development. Connection to Willow Road and Colony Drive to the west. Connectivity to the areas south towards the county was also a concern. Mr. Spriggs stated that there is a stub street that will connect towards Lattice Drive to the west, and there is also a stub street to the south.
There's nothing in there, though, that would indicate that Mr. Spriggs has changed his mind toward the multifamily housing being suited for the land use plan, is there?
I'm all the way down to the motion, and no. I mean, the motion basically states it was by Mr. Kelton to recommend approval to the city council as presented for a rezoning from R1 single family residential to planned development multifamily and RS7 single family. We, the MAPC, find the change in zoning follows the criteria for zoning changes and follows good land use principles. Motion was seconded by Holscher and with the following conditions. And you want me to read these conditions? I mean, y'all have got these conditions.
Yes, please.
Yes, okay. The proposed development shall satisfy all requirements of the city engineer, satisfying all the requirements of the current stormwater drainage design manual and the FEMA floodplain regulations. That the planned development maximum density shall not exceed 5.9 units per acre, 22 fourplex townhomes. Maximum density shall not exceed 5.6 units per acre, 22 single level duplexes. Maximum density shall not exceed 4.5 units per acre, 12 single level fourplexes. And for the RS7 single family detached homes, shall have a maximum density of 7 units per acre on 37 single family lots. That a future site development plan must be submitted and reviewed by the MAPC prior to the future redevelopment. The applicant agrees to comply with the master street plan recommendations for Ingalls Road right-of-way. Fencing details depicting screening shall be implemented along the entire perimeter of the proposed site as approved by MAPC. A lighting photometric plan shall be submitted with the building permit application to ensure no lighting spillage onto abutting properties. And the MAPC recommends approval of the proposed concept plan, including 8.36 plus or minus acres of common open space and the approved street layout and connectivity. And then that motion was by Kelton, seconded by Holscher, and it was voted 5-2 with two people absent at the meeting.
So obviously, two people did not think that this was the best use of this land. Is all my, would you surmise that since they voted against it?
They voted against it. I don't know what they were thinking, but they did vote against it.
I saw where, well, there's two different, one of them said the petition opposed was 289, and I know several people came and spoke, but they didn't seem to discuss any of the concerns of the immediate residents of that area. Did they actually discuss, well, you weren't there. I don't know if they actually allowed them to discuss that and factored in their concerns with them, or they just ignored it, or what. But if you have, even if only half of 150 were residents of that immediate subdivision, that's kind of a concern to me that you wouldn't want to ignore the people who've invested made the biggest investments of their lives in that subdivision, and you just say, well, we're really not worried about what you guys think. You voted with your life savings, and we're going to skip over that. I think that's awful light, cursory look at that to do it. But were you there, Mr. Cook?
I'm still concerned if their concern was just new development or the fact that multifamily was involved, because the density is not much different than as it's currently zoned. So I know it would be additional traffic, but I'm a little confused about the reason for the concerns.
We don't have anybody here to say what they were.
They're always worried about change. Any neighborhood, they're going to be worried about change, and they're always concerned, and usually they always think that the worst that can happen will happen. Usually not ever that bad, but that's just people.
And I know Mr. Cook was there, you know, at least at one of the meetings, because, you know, a lot of the comments were the same as, you know, that he were similar to what he made tonight, but.
The speed of the traffic, there's a lot of speeding problems. The police department has been making a presence in the area, and I will say that has slowed it down. And then, certain hours of the day, yes, the traffic is higher. But if you get there on that corner where I live, you see more and more and more every day. A lot of people come through there to miss the getting on and off of the interstate up there. So, and you'd have to live there to understand.
And you mentioned cyclists earlier, and I actually rode my bike out there today. But, you know, once again, my question is it sounds to me like the concern is any development out there is a concern.
No, I'm not objecting.
No. Because the density, and the density is actually a little bit less, or the units are a little bit less as proposed than the way it's currently zoned. So if these 200 units were going up, you know, in 2 years, I mean, I would have a lot more concern over the traffic. But to me, it sounds like they're going up at about the same pace that, you know, a regular subdivision would be developed. So
I haven't heard any concern over single-family developments. I have for the multifamily.
Not the buildings the same, not the number of people in there. There's a difference between
one at a time, please, because this
is between one single family home and four duplexes, even though it's one structure.
You have a transient issue there. More single family residents, people that live there are more stable, they're there longer because they buy that house. To me, page 5, item 17 of this thing, of this the decision here, it says, and I agree, that not all criteria should be given equal weight. Same thing that Mr. Dover said a while ago. However, I feel the more important statement actually comes after that, which says the criteria shall include but not be limited to that list. And with that being said, I'd like to add a number 8 to that list. A number 8, which says that I'm going to try to keep the promise that I made to people in whom I represent and who put me in this chair. 9 is my intuition, which I feel is neither capricious, which is by definition a sudden and unacceptable change in mood or behavior, or it's not arbitrary, which is by definition would be a decision based on a random choice. I think after all the discussion that we've heard tonight and going through all of this, I don't know how one could say a decision being made after tonight would be arbitrary or capricious. And also, I'd like to expand a minute on page 6, number 18, and give this disclaimer. On any decision, I think, well, I know from my case, I can't speak for anybody else, but the lack of question, debate, banter back or forth does not equate to a lack of prior review, internal deliberation, or an adequate foundation for a solid decision on anything that I make, because a lack of questions that I may have may not indicate me not spending hours of review prior to the decision. So, and the way that this is put, there's absolutely no way that we could formulate any type of criteria that would indicate that any amount or lack of amount of discussion on any issue, you know, would be enough to satisfy this. No way. No way. There's absolutely no way that we could say, have we spent enough time on this to adequately satisfy this court order? Absolutely no way. I think what also has to be understood is that I know for me, and I respect everyone on this council, I think would do the same, that they give an adequate amount of deliberation either by themselves, I know that I do, on every single issue that we vote on. So to assume or to insinuate a lack of prior, a prior review or internal deliberation or anything like that is arbitrary and actually, you know, says a lot less about this council than I think it deserves.
Let me make a comment on that if I can. If you just go over to page 8, and this is again.
One thing, please. If this council approves that, it won't be 2 years till that place will be full of houses. I promise you.
Okay. Let me just, again, and you all have read this order. I've read it several times. On page 8, and again, at the very in the last page, the Judge Fogelman basically said that a better procedure for this case is to reverse and remand it back to City Council to approve, to properly consider. This goes back to what Alderman Long was saying, consider the proposal with the court maintaining, there you go, with the court maintaining its jurisdiction for further action if necessary. Which means he can go back again like he's done on two other and state that he will rezone it. The next paragraph says, and this is more to me, this court is not directing the city of Jonesboro to come to any particular conclusion, but it is ordering the city to follow its own ordinance and to specifically consider the approval criteria contained in Jonesboro City Ordinance 117-34. That's exactly why I asked that question at the very beginning. Okay, that's the bottom line. You can have all the discussion, you can have all the opinions you want. And if we all had our own opinions, they wouldn't all agree. And I think that's what Councilman Dover said a while ago, like in the deal of what is probably or on the deal. You don't know if it is or are. So, you know, I guess my question is, has all the aldermen looked at this decision? Have you looked at it? And have you done your due diligence based on all the steps? It's based on 117-34. And if you have done that, then vote your convictions. But you have to do your due diligence on every line item in 117-34. Okay? Well, we could be here till July and still be talking and talking about the traffic. We could talk about this. Okay? And again, I'm not saying, all I'm saying to you, we've had a lot of great discussion tonight. And basically, your senior planner has gone through every line item on the criteria of 117-34. You all have put in a lot of input. You've put your opinions in that, and that's good. It is your opinion, and you'll vote your convictions. Mm-hmm. The court still has the final decision, whether you, whatever you vote, okay, to come back and make another decision, which they have done on three different occasions. Mm-hmm. So I just say that for the record. And so,
Mayor, at this point, is the council ready for Daryl to answer your original question?
Go ahead.
I'll just ask if in looking at this MAPC report, if we were to take the advice of our former city planner, he would say that multifamily is not consistent. I mean, that's what it's black and white, right?
I mean, I can't speak for him.
What did he write? What did he write?
It's not written in here. I mean, it's not written that he says that it's consistent.
Well, let me back up. The planning department made these recommendations and they gave the yes or no consistency, right?
They put in there that there was partial consistency.
But they also said inconsistent as multifamily.
They did say inconsistent as multifamily.
Numerous times.
Numerous times.
In the report.
Yes.
Okay.
That's my problem, too. It looks like they ignored the advice of the planner and just skipped over and did what they wanted to do. If you look at it and you actually base it on this and base it on the criteria,
but I got to get some.
It's inconsistent all the way through it.
Don't call for vote.
Daryl, are we ready for Daryl to answer the question? There was a question asked by the mayor originally.
I'm going to have to repeat the question now. I'm sorry.
Pardon me?
Can you repeat your original question?
Are you talking about, I said that what I said is based on the order from the court. And the court is that each, every individual council member, okay, would look, is that what you're talking about?
No, after Mr. Parker gave his presentation and we called Daryl up to the podium, I believe you asked Daryl what his decision would have been regarding this, what his recommendation would have been regarding this rezoning request. Mm-hmm. And then before he was able to answer, Mr.
My recommendation, I'm not sure I would have had it. I didn't sit through the meetings. I didn't talk with the applicants. I'm just getting this on the second hand. Would I, if I would have wanted multifamily in this area, or if I would have looked at multifamily in this area, I would have looked at it as a planned development. I wouldn't have done it as a straight multifamily zoning. Would I have asked for maybe some additional single family instead of just, you know, instead of basically you've got one row of single family or one street, would I have asked for a little additional? Maybe we might have talked about something like that. But like I said, that's what I would have done, but I wasn't here. And what I don't think what Otis did is wrong. I think he did exactly what, you know, he had a new zoning that he was working with, and he was trying to get something that fit, and he was trying to work with the developer and also try to work with the, you know, get something for the whole neighborhood. But like I said, you're asking me to go back and think, you know, well, I'm not going to say what he did was wrong, because I don't think it was. I think he did what he thought was right. We all would have done something a little different probably, but right. I'm not sure I would have been far off from this if I was sitting in his spot 5 years ago or 6 years ago, whatever it was. Okay.
So again, to reiterate, Otis did not recommend multifamily housing.
I don't see where he ever said.
Right, thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Any other questions from the council members? Okay. Okay.
I was there throughout all those council or MAPC meetings, and we had numerous discussions not only with MAPC but also with the planning staff. And I would challenge you, Mr. Dover, to go back to any staff report prepared by either this planner or Mr. Spriggs or any other planner that you've had. And he goes down and he looks strictly at the land use plan. But what's also in your report at tab G, I believe it is the study that the mayor had commissioned in connection with the moratorium committee. This council, during the period of time covered by that report, didn't follow the land use plan 57% of the time. 57. Not 10, not 15, 57. And then you also asked what I thought was question about how they voted. It was a 5-2 vote, but I'll just simply ask you this question. You know what they call a 5-4 decision from the United States Supreme Court?
The law of the land.
The law of the land. So it requires five. It doesn't matter whether it's 5-0 or it's 5-4. It requires five votes or recommendation.
Mr. Parker, to address Mr. Cook's concern about the amount of time Is there anticipated timeline if this is approved, how long it would take to build it out?
These being small lots, I mean, again, this is our best guess. But Unico Bank will not be the developer. They've made no bones about it. They will sell this property. This will probably be small investor driven. And by what I have seen and what I know about the development business personally, it will take 5 to 10 years to build this many units. You're not going to have, in a project like this, a big developer come in and swoop it all up and build them all, because they want to build in tight density.
Okay.
Where they get a bigger bang for the buck, if you will.
Like on Johnson.
Like on Johnson and what they're doing out around ASU with the Zimmer Group.
Right.
But this plan, as Mr. Smith alluded to, it was originally proposed as RM8. Based on discussions and working with the city planner, you say he didn't recommend it. Well, he didn't come out and recommend it because it didn't comply 100% with the land use plan. But we worked with the planner, and he is the one who suggested coming back, and after we got the flooding issue addressed, suggested we come back with a planned development, multifamily. And again, he seemed to, and I can tell you from my discussions with him, he really liked the idea that the density was limited to 5.4 units per acre, which was consistent practically with the density in Caldwell Acres. You weren't increasing density. The other big thing I want this council to understand is if this property is not rezoned, Unico Bank is not going to buy the Watson property. Therefore, it's got a tract of almost 40 acres or 30 some odd acres that will all be developed as single family, all access through Keeley and Lexi, which will be the difference of 111 lots or 37 lots. You're going to put a lot of pressure and a lot more traffic in Caldwell Acres if this property is developed all as single family residential. Thank you.
I have one question. Make sure I understood what you said. You said Otis recommended multifamily, but yet in his report he said it was inconsistent.
I didn't say that, Councilman Dover. What I said was he recommended that we change from RM8 to a planned development multifamily district, so the City Council and the Planning Commission would have more control on how it developed. It has to be developed exactly as it's presented, or the developer has to come back before you guys and convince you whatever he wants to do to change it, you all have to agree to it.
Okay. All right. Any other questions? Desire of the council, we have a motion or call for a vote. This cannot be, it's my understanding, in talking to legal counsel here, we cannot send this back to MAPC. So it will have to be voted on. Am I correct on that?
That's my understanding.
So you have to vote on this?
It'll have to be made in the form of a positive, too. So for that purpose, I move to approve. Yeah,
you got it right here. Pardon me?
Move to adopt.
Motion. I have a motion to adopt, and I have a second. Okay. Let's call the roll, please.
Mr. Vance?
Aye.
Dr. Coleman?
Aye.
Ms. Williams?
Aye.
Mr. Gibson?
Aye.
Mr. Street?
No.
Mr. Johnson?
No.
Mr. Dover?
No.
Mr. Hafner?
Aye.
Mr. Long?
No.
Mr. McClain?
No.
You have five. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
That's a tie.
So it passed.
No.
No, it's 5 and 5.
It's 5 and 5.
Okay. So it's 5 and 5. So I will have to vote. And I will vote aye.
Of course.
Okay. All right. Let's see. The next item on the agenda will be the mayor's report. And mayor's report. And I'm going to be very brief. I'm going to run through this because I know we're taking a lot of time, and I understand everybody wants to get out of here and see the new fire truck, which is the new ladder truck, is in the back. Okay. So, first of all, the paper stated we had a great trip in D.C., meeting several of the agencies. The concerns I think you all would have, the same as I, and that was the CBDG for our low and moderate income, and we were given a very positive feedback from all of our legislators, Senator Bozeman, and those that they feel like that that will stay in the budget, not be back in the budget, will not be taken out. We went through, and I think I sent you all a memorandum or summary of everything that we went on, and we're going to be visiting with the Highway Department, the Federal Highway Administration, on the 25th on another project. Next item, again, is building permits. This city continues to be blessed in the fact that residential permits last month were $5.6 million, almost $5.7 million, $3.7 million on commercial, for a total of $9,466,000. That's a good month. I want to give you two things. I give you actually two things to look at. One is an overlay update. You can see that we're very aggressive on our overlays. We appreciate that, and we've had several of them done. It's color-coded on yellow. The next, I think Steve is here, but anyway, the next one will be moving out to Sage Meadows. So there's three large streets there that will be done as soon as Atlas can get out there. The next one, just real quick, I know y'all are concerned about some of the highway infrastructure on Southwest Drive in Highland. It would be anticipated we would bid that probably late 17, possibly early 18. Highway 49 and Parker Road will be let probably in late 18. Harrisburg Road will be let in probably late 18. And Highway 1 will be let probably in late 17. So we're right on target on some of those projects, and we'll certainly keep you up to date on those. So that's all I have in the mayor's report. Oh, excuse me, let me back up. I've never seen such a large crowd at any event since I've been mayor, going on 9 years, that it was to the hub today. And I've got to give special recognition to Dana Moore and all that task force, and Kimberly and Emma Agnew, who secured the $90-something thousand grant for the homeless for the citizens in Craighead, Poinsett, and Greene County. And that was packed today. And in fact, we had donations. I could not believe it. All the furniture was donated, set up in there. And it will be starting right now. Doors will probably open tomorrow. Wow. So that is something that you all and I have been working on for some time on our homeless. So I just wanted to share that with you. I'm sure you'll see it on KEIT tonight, where they interviewed Dana and some others. So anyway, I just wanted to say that. I'll start with next item. Item will be City Council reports. Councilman Street.
The Public Works meeting earlier tonight, we took up Resolution 17036 for the purpose of widening Patrick Street. I'd move we suspend the rules and place it on tonight's agenda.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. We suspend the rules and add Resolution 17036 to the agenda. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed. All right.
Okay. Resolution to the City of Jonesboro, Arkansas, to accept the low bid and enter into a contract with Willis Incorporated for the Patrick Street widening 2017-14. Whereas the City of Jonesboro desires to accept the low bid and enter into a contract for the Patrick Street widening, whereas the low bidder and the firm selected for the Patrick Street widening is Gillis Incorporated, whereas funding for the execution of the contract shall come from the capital improvements budget, and compensation shall be paid in accordance with the contract documents. Now therefore be it resolved by the City Council for the City of Jonesboro, Arkansas, that Section 1, that the City of Jonesboro shall accept the low bid and enter into a contract for the Patrick Street widening, there's typos in this, is Gillis Incorporated. Section 2, that funding for the execution of the contract shall come from the capital improvements budget, and compensation shall be paid in accordance with the contract documents. Section 3, the mayor and the city clerk are hereby authorized by the City Council for the City of Jonesboro to execute all documents necessary to effectuate this agreement.
Move to adopt.
Have a motion and a second to adopt. Any question or comment?
I got a couple questions. How much are we talking coming from capital improvement?
$186,000 or something like that?
$127,860 is what it's coming at.
Okay.
The contract itself. That's for the entire overlay and doing the widening of the road, curb, and the whole deal that Gillis had on his contract.
And where is this on Patrick? When you say Patrick, I know.
Where to where?
Yeah, where are we going?
Washington to
Street.
To Krath.
Washington to Krath. Okay. We budgeted $250,000 this year for this project, and we're getting it done for $127,000. So,
oh, wow. Came in much lower. Okay. Any other questions?
So this was already budgeted. We're not pulling out of reserve.
No, this is already budgeted.
That's all I've got, Mayor.
Okay.
We got a vote.
Okay, all right, so we didn't vote on it, so all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right. I'll ask engineering tomorrow to start, Tracy to start getting the bed, the bond, so we can go ahead and get this thing going. We've been waiting on this now for probably 2 years, right, Dr. Coleman?
Yeah.
So we're going to get in that road to Stone there. You can get two cars down there. So, okay, is that all?
Yes, that's all I've got, Mayor.
Okay, Councilman Johnson?
No, thank you.
Councilman Dover?
No.
The only thing I want to say is we do have an A&P meeting, our first one of the year tomorrow at 1:30 in these chambers, so.
Good. Okay, Councilman Law?
No, thank you.
Okay. Councilman McClain?
Nothing.
All right.
No, sir.
Nothing. Okay. Dr. Coleman? Bye. Okay.
No, sir.
All right. All right, that concludes the mayor's reports. Next is in the city council report, we go down to public comments. Anybody in the audience want to speak on any issue that has not been talked about tonight? Seeing none, the next item is adjournment.
So moved.
Thank you. Again, the fire truck's in the back.
My goodness.
So.